as I look at all people, but I find you extremely intriguing because of our conversation in the pre-show. There were so many different things you said that I didn't piggyback on and I wanted to talk about, but I wanted to save it for the show.
Okay.
First thing I want to talk about is a follow-up to something you said in the pre-show. That day that we were talking, you were doing a project around the house. You remember what it was?
The walls?
Yes.
We were decorating the walls.
Yes. You were doing that. Do you often do handyman type projects yourself?
Not all the time.
Not all the time?
No, all the time.
All the time?
My boyfriend, and I drive him crazy.
Yeah, that's what I was kind of leading up to, and you just said it. I was going to ask, so how does your boyfriend work that out? Because you're walking around with a tool belt on, or you get the hammer and just start.
No, the best part is, I don't even do it. He does it.
So you get him started. Is that, you put that guilt thing into a guy's head and go like, you know, no, she goes, no, look at your face though. Yes, you do. Okay, so how does it work? So, come on. Tell the woman's secret. Tell what you women. Go ahead. Tell the secret. So,
you know what? I started watching TikTok and I started watching all of these really cheap ways to decorate your walls.
Okay.
Right. And I'm like, yeah. Oh, for less than $100, I can have, because I live in this beautiful little townhome, but it's a very long room, I guess. It's all one room, but it's very, very blah. It's very plain. And I don't know, for me, I have tons and tons of my kids' pictures from them growing up, but I've just never got around to having them framed. So my walls are totally bare. So I'm like, okay, how can I make my house look pretty, but for not, a lot of money? Right. So I was looking through TikTok, and I showed him and said, hey, you know, for just a few dollars, we can get some of this trim. So we went to Lowe's, we went to Home Depot, and we looked at the trim. And then it went from having like those picture frames to then a chair rail to then the last thing is the molding on the ceiling. So, of course, you know, his dad had the miter saw, and then we went and rented a nail gun for the day. And
oh, my goodness. Yeah.
So it kind of progressed from there to then, while we were in Home Depot and Lowe's, the flooring that I wanted was half price.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, it just continued. You just, yeah. Oh, I know. The H word came out. Honey. And every man, of course, succumbs to it. You call any man honey. I'm telling you if I was 20, I didn't know it. But I think back to my dad. Listen, women, if you use the H word on a man, it doesn't matter how mad you made him. He will melt like a, what do you want? You know, it's like, what do you, you use the H, so you use the H word on him, honey. And you got the flooring, didn't you?
So I got the flooring too.
Man, you women are good, man.
So it went from decorating my walls, which looks absolutely fantastic. I'm very proud of him because he's never done that kind of work before.
Right.
And it progressed. So we did, I mean, most of my downstairs is hardwood, but in the, like the lobby area and the bathroom and just outside the bathroom is like a little area. And he did those in like that vinyl planking that's very popular these days, which is waterproof and stuff.
All right. Yeah.
So that's all laid now, but I still have extra because I have a big kitchen area.
I'm going to say you got somewhere else you want to put, don't you?
I have quite a big kitchen area, but I said, you know, babe, we're just going to leave that till after Christmas because...
Oh, aren't you kind? Aren't you kind?
Here's the thing. I also have my daughter living with me most of the time, and she's like, Mom, this year I would really like a real Christmas tree.
Oh, okay. So you're gonna hold off.
So, yeah, we went to get the Christmas tree on Sunday, and we happened to get one of the biggest trees that would fit in my house, and it pretty much takes over my whole living room. So there's no room for anything else now.
So let me see if I understand this correctly. So your daughter has watched you master how to get him to do stuff, and she turned that on you so that she can get Christmas.
She asked me last year too, and I said, well, no, because I've got a fake one I've been using for years, but I have high ceilings. I have 8-foot ceilings, but my tree is like 6 feet. So my tree kind of looks tiny.
8-foot ceiling. My Lord, you know, you the other day when we were talking, you know, you kind of got from one spot and you went to go talk to your son, I think it was, because he was going to, you banished the shower for him at that moment and told him, didn't you tell him he had to go outside and use the water hose or something like that? No, I'm just kidding. No, you didn't. No, I just, some work was going on or something like that. But you took me kind of through the house. You have a very nice home.
It's very cute. It's only like 6 years old. I just moved into it a couple of years ago.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So you got a lot of people coming on here telling you that they love you and they asking, how are you? So please answer that. How are you? Let's just get that out of the way. Even though we said it already,
I'm great.
Okay. All right. Let's just get that out of the way so that they're okay with that. And by the way, if you have any questions for Jill, put them in the question section, not in the comments. If you have some questions, this question section is right next to the comment section at the bottom of the screen. There's a little blurb there that has a question mark in it. Feel free to type your questions in there. I'll do my best to get to them. But again, Jill is the star of the show, not me. And I love everybody coming on, but I'm going to talk to Jill about some things. But feel free to ask her any questions. And I'm her bodyguard today. So I will be filtering out anything that sounds creepy. So anyhow, here we go. We're going to start. And I just kind of got that out of the way, what we just did, because now I'm going to go super fast. I'm going to go super fast and throw some stuff at you, because this is, I normally do this on my Red Flag podcast page, but I moved it over to this page, Narc Abuse TV, with you. I haven't done this before. I'm going to do this with you. Sometimes I normally do this on my other two pages in which we talk about life. Okay, here we go. I'm going to ask you a series of things, and you just go ahead and speak your mind, but especially speak your feelings, your heart. This semi-game is pretty much based upon how you feel about certain things that I mentioned. No, it won't be about politics. No, it won't be about religion. And no, it won't be about anything else that's controversially stupid to talk about. So, all about fun. Here we go. Cats or dogs? What do you prefer?
Dogs.
Dogs. Why do you prefer dogs?
I have one.
I know. I knew you were going to go, because I got one. So you did it too.
Okay. I have a great big one somewhere around.
Yeah. What's the dog's name?
Buster.
Buster. I've seen some of the pictures. Cute dog. All right. Here we go. You ready? You started modeling when?
Originally when I was 25, but that didn't last very long.
Okay.
Life got in the way. I did some background work on movies and stuff. Did quite a few movies and I was trying to think. Yeah, it's all movies background I did when I was 25, and then I started again when I was 48.
Okay. Okay, so I have to ask this. Now, see, one question leads to other questions that are not on here.
Of course.
And all of these. So you just said that. So that pops into my head now is to ask you, if you had to describe modeling for you on a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being the best, how would you rate that modeling experience you've had so far on a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being the best?
5.
A 5. Okay. So there's room for growth. All right. All right. So here we go. Name. No, don't do that. Don't say or don't name. There are disrespectful things men say to women or do to women. What are some of them that irritate you?
Well, since I'm now older,
you said whatever age you said, but we know that you're actually only 39. So it's okay. You're forever 39.
All right, So there's two, if anybody on my page calls me a MILF, I will totally delete it. And the other one is Cougar.
Okay.
Because I think they're totally disrespectful for women. There's no need. There's no name out there for a guy like that. So why would you put it out there as for a woman? So for me, that's, yeah.
Only a man would think of coming up with names for women. A woman has never came up with names for herself like that. Now I got to piggyback. I got to ask another question. Okay, so in modeling, when you're doing modeling, because no one would ever want to take a picture of me, So in modeling, tell me your experience when you were younger. Is it something you can say it's different when I was younger than now? Has it gotten worse or bad?
You know what? There's a lot more photographers now who are not photographers who like to think they're photographers because they go to the store, they buy a camera, and then they'll put it online. Hey, I have a camera. I'll take pictures of you. And then, you know, I see a lot of work of people that say they're professional photographers, and I look at their work and go, no, you're not a professional photographer because you've literally got a camera and you have no idea what you're doing. You've got it in auto and you've just pushed the button. And that comes with experience too. I mean, I've worked with a lot of photographers, some professional, some not professional, right? So it just comes with experience, and you've really got to do your homework and your background on people too, right? And even, you know, some professional people can be kind of slimy too, right? So you've got to do your homework on photographers. And, you know, is it just going to be you and the photographer? Well, you know what? Guess what? Then have at least a stylist or a makeup artist there or somebody else.
Right.
Because it lessens the odds of them hitting on you or whatever, right?
Or getting uncomfortable or out of control.
Yeah.
Have you heard of or seen situations where that has been the case?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I've been hit on so many times. I refuse to work with photographers now unless there's a stylist or a makeup artist around.
Good for you. Okay, here we go. Oh, man. I don't know if I should ask you this one this early, but here we go. I'm going to do it anyhow. You have children.
Yes, you have three.
Three of them, I think you told me. Okay, so you have three. Name one positive quality for each one of them. If you want to name more, that's totally up to you. We got plenty of time. But you have three children. Can you name one positive quality about each one of them? If you can name more, that's fine. Now, to your children, I'll say this, whether they're watching now or they see this later. Please do not get jealous of each other. Your mom loves you all across the board exactly the same. She just only likes some of you better than others. No, just kidding. No, I'm just joking. That's not true. Okay. Name one positive quality.
Okay. Do you want the name as well, you said?
Hey, yeah, go ahead. Whatever.
All right. So my oldest is very, very driven.
Okay.
My second one, Adriana, is very, very creative.
Okay.
And my son is very, very sporty.
Did you say sporty?
Yes.
Now, for those who are stateside that have no idea and don't watch British programs, I have an idea of what you mean
by
that.
Well, they're Canadian, so they're not English, so.
Oh, okay. But you describe them as sporty.
Yeah, my son has been in sports since he was like yay high.
Okay. So I just wanted you to say that because the Americans will go like, well, what does that mean? Because they don't, trust me, Americans have no idea what the word sporty
is. All of my kids are sporty. So
I know, but
my
thank you for
son
walking.
Particularly so, because he still plays his hockey. And
what sports did you play when you were growing up?
I play competitive badminton and tennis.
Oh, wait, that's right. Yeah, so you do tennis. So are you extremely competitive?
I can be.
Okay. So since you're competitive, have you ever found yourself in situations where you felt competitive toward another woman?
No.
I
played county badminton. So yeah, I was playing other women all the time.
But we're talking sport-wise. That's sports. Have you found where women are competitive or overly insecure or jealous of you?
I never really got involved in anything. I would go in, play my sport and leave. I never got into, and I mean, when I was growing up, there wasn't all of that kind of bullying and disrespect like there is today. In school, there was a little bit of, I guess, gossip mongers against the people that didn't play sports, but I really didn't take any notice and I just didn't get involved.
Now, you mentioned something that is actually, I'm going to put this card down because you did that with the children. That was actually beautiful. And you just said the word bullying, and that is actually on my other card that I have for you. And it's just that one word, bullying. What's your take on bullying today?
It's tough. It really is. I mean, my kids have been through it. grade eight was horrendous with my oldest. I went into the school a few times and she's like, mom, don't get involved. I went, oh, hell yeah, I'm getting involved.
Mama bear comes out.
Right? I'm like, you go after my kids, you go after me. Yeah. Right? And I'm not having it. And then actually they went after me too, because I was getting into modeling too.
Wow.
And it was one of the moms that was saying things about me because I was getting into modeling, and it just turns out that she was jealous and stuff, but it was ridiculous. I'm like, seriously, you're going after my kid? My kid's your kid's friend and blah, blah, blah. It was just ridiculous.
You stand up for your children. You speak in their behalf. You love your children. What was it like for you growing up? Who was in your corner? Who backed you?
Me. I was a loner in school. I had maybe one or two friends. I wasn't really close to a lot of people. I did my own thing. Never told my mom anything. People called me names, but I didn't care. I just kept to myself. And I guess I've always been quite shy until lately. Or I don't have a choice. I think modeling brings that out of somebody. If somebody's very, very shy and doesn't talk much, which I never did, I was very quiet. So, and I certainly didn't go in front of a camera as a child.
But you have a lot of stories, though. You have a lot of stories of your life and things that have happened to you. No, okay. You told me a story. Now, come on now. I'm debating on how to bring the story out of you. Whether you remember the story or not, that's okay, because I'm going to remember it. It'll be just something between you and I. It was really funny.
Are you talking about the manure story? Because you really...
I was going a long way to make you say it. So yes, that one. But I'll tell you, I didn't want to tell it. I told you I wasn't going to... That's the first of all, my shows are unscripted, and this is about as close as having a scripted show is that moment you just saw, because I know exactly the story and I think it's a great story. So please tell the story of the pile. So
I don't even know how old I was, probably about maybe 6 or 7, because it was just me and my older sister. And I was actually born in the Lake District in Kirby and Furness. So every now, my mom and dad lived there for a while. Up until I was only one. I moved when I was one, but we would always go back and visit their friends. So these particular friends had this beautiful farm with cows, and I'm sure they had other animals too. But so, yeah, so I, at the time, loved cats. So I found this, you know, they have farm cats, as they do. And I had this little kitten in my arms, and I was saw the mom on the top of the wall, and there was this pile of what I thought was dirt going up to the wall, and I had no wellies on, and I climbed up the pile to take the kitten to its mom, only it wasn't dirt, it was a pile of manure. So I sunk into the manure halfway up, lost my wellies, the cat ran away to his mom. He got away, and yeah, I ended up getting hosed out, but my sister came in after me, but she didn't get all the way up to her knees like I did and beyond. And we ended up getting hosed down in the farmyard. And it was pretty damn cold in it with a cold hose pipe. But I just remember my parents all the way home with the windows open going, oh my God, you reek.
So have you found that to be sometimes in life that you will find yourself going through a pile and still coming out, having to be hosed down? And you, I don't know. That's a really strange analogy. I don't know. That means something somewhere in your life. I know it does. That if you're willing to go through that and get hosed down with cold water, you can go through anything, Jill. You're that tough that you can survive.
It's funny through life. I mean, I've had so many knockbacks in my. It was really nice when I was talking to my mom one day, and I don't know. As we were growing up, our parents never really came out and told us they loved us, and my mom, so I was very close to my gran. I used to, the last few years of my gran's life, I would drive around everywhere because I had my little mini in England, and I would drive around everywhere. And so she would always say to me, your mom loves you. Your mom loves you. I'm like, no, she doesn't. She's always yelling at me. She's always screaming at me. She's, you know, and she's like, no, she loves you. And it wasn't until I'd been over here for at least 25 years, and she actually came over to here, and she was leaving, and she said, "I love you," at the airport. And I went, "Mom, that is the first time in my life you have ever told me you love me." And she went, "No, I've told you before." And I went, "You have never, ever, ever said those words to me." And I was just bawling my eyes out because it was the first time ever she'd seen it. She says it more often now because all her grandkids tell her too, right? But it was just, yeah, it was the first time.
And that was how long ago?
About 5 years ago.
About 5 years ago. You started modeling about 6 years ago. That happened 5 years ago. What has life been like for you since your mother told you that at the airport till now? What has life been like for you knowing that she finally told you something that you had never heard before?
I mean, it's tough because they're all still in England. I'm here in Canada. So, I mean, I used, when my kids were growing up, I would go every year in the summertime to visit them for about a month.
Right.
So, I mean, I guess I knew she did, you know, deep down. Right. But it's tough being over here. And as they're getting older too, right? So my dad's, yeah, he turned 90 in May, and I was supposed to be there. And of course, with COVID, I couldn't get there. And my mom's 78. So it's tough. But nothing really changed. But again, I guess as she gets older too, she's seeing what I've gone through, and I've been, you know, kicked down and down and down. And she, another thing she said to me not even that long ago was, "I'm really proud of you because you just keep getting up." And she said, "I've never seen anybody get so many kicks as you."
Yeah.
And I'm like, "But what else am I supposed to do?"
Yeah.
You know, because I am here all by myself. I don't have any family from England here with me. So, you know, my own family, I've got my own kids, and, you know, life is what you make it, right?
Yeah, it's you know what? You can have moments of a pile of manure, and certain times you can have moments where you're not dealing with manure. But either way it goes, you just keep trudging through, right? We have to keep making the best out of every situation. We can't ignore our emotions either and how we feel about things. But what I find interesting and I like about you, what I like about you is that you find a way to make life enjoyable, but you don't push yourself on other people.
I don't care whether people like me or they don't.
Yeah, see, that's where you're getting some love on the screen there. By the way, I got to say this real quick. You do the same thing I do when you see other people's names on Instagram. I don't understand their names sometimes, and I can't say them. I can't say, right? It's like a thing. When you said it, I was going like, "Oh, you have no idea how you and I are on the same page." I love everybody, but come on, guys, come up with some names that people can say.
What I just said, right? If I can't read your profile name, I will not shout it out.
I will
acknowledge that you're there. Maybe if it's a number, it's like 91 blah blah. Then, hi, how you doing? Right? Or if I can say the first one, look, I've got a sexy whatever that is. Right. Yeah.
And he said, "Well, and you're getting a hello." And see, my thing is sometimes I don't know whether it's a guy or a girl. So I don't. What? No, I've already done it. I've already told, "Hey, you know what? Thank you so much. You know, that's a great comment. You know, thank you, sir," or something like that. And then they'll type right back, "I'm a woman." You know, I'm like, "I'm sorry, I didn't know." Pick a name that sounds like a female. I don't know. Anyhow, so all right, our emotions are very important. And right now, I have a series of questions that will involve your emotions.
Okay.
Are you ready? Are you ready? Okay, here we go. Here we go. Very, very important. If you have some tissue nearby, you may need it because this is going to be very, very, very important. See, somebody just did it. See, I am a woman. I'm so sorry. Okay. All right.
She loves the two kids too. So
yes, we're getting. Kids. Yes. You know what it is? When you do the lives, especially the first time you see the name, because we're in a moment, we don't have time to really let it all register. And the picture is so small. Anyhow, forget that. Okay. Here we go. Emotions. These are three emotional questions that will involve your feelings.
Okay.
First of all, what's your favorite dish or food?
I hate food. I hate food.
I deliberately ask you this question.
I hate food.
Wait, first of all, now because we said about people's names, people are now scrolling. I am a man. I am a woman. What is wrong with you people? What's wrong with you guys? Now everybody's just, okay, so you hate food. But wait, this is the reason I'm asking these questions. We'll get to that part later about you hate food. Okay, you want to, it's a spaghetti. No, the question is not for you guys. It's for her. What is wrong with these people? Okay, you guys are, okay, that's funny. Okay, madame, that's funny. You love spaghetti. I love spaghetti too. Okay, so back to Jill, because the question was for her, not for you guys. What's your favorite dish or food? What favorite dish or food does your, if your boyfriend cooks something for you or your children, what food do they cook or whatever that you like? You just, okay. And you are a nutritionist.
Chicken.
Yeah, okay. All right, so here we go. Chips and fish. Okay, come on, you guys. Okay, that's pretty funny. Okay, that's funny. Chips and fish. Okay,
you know what? If I lived in England before I was a nutritionist, before I got onto my health kick, then it would have been chips. Not so much the fish, because I'm not really a fish person, but okay. It would have been English chips from a chippy. But I don't do that anymore.
Okay, all right. You don't do that anymore, which leads right into my second question. Thank you very much. You just shot that question down. Here goes the second question. If you had to choose from these four foods, these are all questions that deal with your emotions and your feelings. So if you feel like crying at any moment, they are such tough questions. Feel free to. Okay, so here we go. Spinach, fish, eggs, or salad. We know how you feel about fish now. Spinach, fish, eggs, salad. Which two would you prefer to eat?
Eggs and salad. I eat every day.
Eggs and salad. You eat eggs and salad every day.
I have eggs for every morning for breakfast. Boiled eggs.
Boiled eggs every morning. Mm-hmm. Eggs and salad. Okay. So now, as a nutritionist, mm-hmm. as a person who is into healthy eating, what do you recommend for individuals that are trying to eat healthy? Can you name four different types of foods or meals or whatever that people can keep in mind?
Well, first of all, we'd cut out the spaghetti.
Oh, man. You know, you're going to start a riot. You're cutting out spaghetti, man. People may turn on you.
Here's the thing, right? So my middle child, Adrienne, she's actually type 1 diabetic.
Okay.
So she was diagnosed just before she was 5 years old. So I have been following her blood sugars for the last 11 years. Mm-hmm. So I know what foods do to your body. Okay. So the thing with pasta, not just spaghetti, pasta and rice is the same. When you first eat it, it causes a spike. Then it causes a crash. 6 hours later, and this is when people usually, if they have it for dinner at nighttime, they'll find that they're wired at like 2 o'clock in the morning, anywhere from like midnight to two, depending on what time they've had dinner. 6 hours later after they've eaten it, they'll get another sugar kick. And this is what happens with the blood sugars. This is how I know, because I used to follow Adriana every now and again when she'd have pasta and rice. Just thank God she's not a huge pasta fan. But we would be up in the middle of the night with her trying to pump her full of insulin to get her sugars down.
Okay.
So, I mean, now as everything's progressed and she's on new pumps and stuff, they can break, you can break up insulin in the way they give it. So they'll double bolus, so you can bolus and break it up into two sections, so they can bolus straight away and then they can bolus however many hours later, because we know it's going to spike and then it's going to kick in then. So yeah, salads, raw foods every single day would definitely be a yes, because we have bacteria in our gut and we have to feed them. So if you think, this is what people don't understand, the bacteria in our gut needs to feed, it needs to eat, okay? And it's actually a good bacteria because it's what keeps us healthy. So if you only eat cooked meals, like cooked food, if you only eat fast food, there is absolutely no nutrients in that food left. So the bacteria cannot get fed. And this is where people will get to maybe 30, 40, and they'll go, oh my God, I keep getting sick. I don't understand why. It's like, well, if you keep eating cooked foods or eating fast food, you're not feeding your bacteria. And then they start to die off. and you don't have enough bacteria in your gut, and you need trillions and trillions of bacteria. So if you feed them, so anytime you have raw food, like fruits, your vegetables, they get fed because the nutrients from those foods gets to the bacteria and they can eat. And there's loads of shows on YouTube that you can actually watch as that happens. And they've done studies on where this kid used to eat raw, then he stopped and he only ate fast food, and his body literally craved salads and vegetables. And that was because the bacteria, they weren't getting fed, they were dying off. So I always say to people as a nutritionist, listen to your body, because it tells you. It's like when you have a newborn. Newborns give you clues, and if you follow those clues, like my oldest daughter, my first baby, 7 o'clock every single night, she would go crazy. I'm like, what is it with this kid at 7 o'clock at night? And I finally figured it out. If I walked upstairs to the nursery where her little crib was, put her down, she would stop crying and she would be settled instantly. I'm like, oh my God, this kid, 7 o'clock, she just wants to be in bed. That's it. She just wants to be by herself. And that was it. So same with your body. You've got to listen to it and it'll give you clues. But your body only has so many tools in its toolbox. So if you do it through fuel, which is what you consume, and I say fuel as what you consume, because if I just talk about food, people forget about all the sugary drinks that they drink. Okay. And that's obviously detrimental to your health, because all the pop and all that sugary stuff, it spikes the insulin, and that's what it's all about. Right. And that's why we have so many people with type 2 diabetes as they get older, and they don't understand how it comes about, because the doctors don't tell them in layman's terms why. It's because your body can't keep up with the amount of sugar that it has to release, the insulin that it has to release to keep all the amount of food. So if you were to eat a plate of pasta, and you have to actually look at the label. And if you understand how to read a label, you'll actually understand how many carbohydrates are in one cup of pasta. And chances are, for I think 3/4 of a cup, depending on the pasta, it's about 65 grams of carbohydrates. And wow, that's a lot.
That's
so people
lot.
Don't usually stop at 3/4 of a cup of pasta. They usually have at least 1.5 cups. So think of 120 cups of 120 carbs, which amounts to, depending on how much insulin your body needs. Okay, so if I turn that around and made that sugar, so now you're looking at 120 carbs. Well, think about 4 grams is 1 teaspoon of sugar.
Okay.
So if you divide 120, say 130, because it's usually 65. If you divide 130 by 4 grams, you come out with, it's about 40 teaspoons of sugar in that one plate of pasta. So then you kind of understand how your body goes, oh my God, I can't keep up with that. And they either get insulin resistant or they become type 2 diabetics. And that's just from one pasta, one plate of pasta. And if they do that every single day, or 2, 3, 4 times a week, and it's the same with rice, then your body just can't keep up with the supply and demand of insulin.
So the body begins to be in a sugar overload type of a situation?
Yeah. Yeah, the insulin is needed because it opens up the cells. And if there's not enough insulin in it, it can't open up the cells, and then the sugar just circulates in the bloodstream.
The sugar circulating in the bloodstream.
The insulin is like a key that opens up the cells. It's like a door, right? If there's not enough insulin, it can't open that door. The sugar can't go into the cells to be used as energy. And then it floats around the bloodstream and it does a lot of damage in the body.
So one of the main things that can really help any of us is to make sure that we're not overloading the body with carbohydrates, or in other words,
yeah,
processed sugar, you're saying?
Yeah, like, well, simple carbohydrates, like, you know, you can eat potatoes. My dad's been eating potatoes for years, but again, like, it's all about portion control. And if you have what's the word I'm looking for If you have trouble with portion control, you have to trick your brain. So here's a really cool way to trick your brain. Put your food on a small plate. Fill your small plate. Don't pile it up, but just fill the small plate. So your brain thinks, oh, I've got lots of food, but it's actually a less amount than what you're used to eating. But right. Your brain doesn't comprehend that. It just sees a lot of food on this plate.
Right.
So you're tricking your brain and it's like, oh, okay, so I'll be good now because I got lots of food.
Right.
But it's less than what you usually eat because it's a smaller plate, but it looks more.
You have just went down a road that I wanted to do with you on my Red Flag podcast page. But I can't make you stop because I want to know. I want to ask you. Now, see, that's a whole nother folder of questions I have sitting over here that I haven't opened up. What we're doing right now. Will you at least agree to, as I've never done this, will you at least agree to being on again on my Red Flag podcast page where we can talk nutrition?
Of course.
But especially even if we don't do it on that one, we do it on the Boom 86 because that's really for millennials. I got a lot of young people, young professionals that mm-hmm. go to that page. I would love to have this discussion on nutrition with you. My time has actually run out for this segment. And I want to hold you to that we're going to do this again, but we're going to talk nutrition next time for sure. But don't feel bad. I've got tons of stuff that I've never even touched on today, and I can't because I'm pressed up against. Let me hold on. I'm looking at time, but I can ask this though. Okay. I can ask this. Thank you for that great information. Matter of fact, it's on the screen. A few people have said that already. Awesome, great information. They got out here, and a few other people have said a few things. Let me get that out of the way there. Okay, so. Before we go, you have just that. I love what you just said. I would love to go longer, but I can't. So here we go. There are types of music that people truly love, and there's music that people don't like. Name the type of music that you don't like.
Rap.
And why you don't like it.
I just don't like it. It's just everything about it.
Yeah. I have to tell you when I found that out, and people, you know, I don't usually ask questions that are loaded in the sense that I already know the answer, but I already knew the answer. So there are types of music that you do like. Which would you describe jazz as number one? Would you describe classical? What do you like to hear? Is it based upon your mood, or is it based upon the group or the singer?
No, it's totally mood. I prefer the older stuff, and it goes way back to like the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, because I just find that the music is just so much more catchy. Yeah. And it kind of, I mean, look at now. I mean, we still go back to those old songs because that's what people love, right?
Yeah.
The stuff that's being produced these days, I just, it doesn't get me. Right. So, I mean, depending on my mood, you know, like I have so many radio stations that I flick through, or I'll just put my own, even country I'll listen to, you know. Barbara Streisand and Celine Dion were my favorites. I mean, Barbara Streisand was my biggie, even with movies.
Wow. Yeah.
You know, Barry Manilow was another one. I mean, he's one of the greatest, you know, singers out there, right? So,
yeah.
But I mean, some of these have passed too.
Have you met any celebrities that in your life? No. Okay. You know that you are a celebrity to some people, right?
I guess so, but I don't see myself as that.
Yeah. Okay. Here we go. Last set of questions. Oh, my goodness. Yeah, so I'm going to really push it. Here we go. So, don't rush your answer. Okay. I'm just gonna rush the question. So, between the ages of 5 and 15 in your life,
mm-hmm.
what did you learn that you could pass on to your children? Between the ages of 5 and 15, what did you learn in life that you could pass on to your children? Advice.
I think that's a tough one. That's only rely on yourself. Okay. I think because I was such a loner.
Okay.
So don't look for, what's the word? You don't need anybody else's opinion to be who you are in life.
Between the ages of 15 and 25, you experienced a number of different types of things. What did you learn between the ages of 15 and 25 that you could pass on as advice to your children?
Well, at the age of 17, I became an entrepreneur. So, and you can do that at any age. And I even my son is 16, and I told him, actually, I got him a little lawn care business going a couple of years ago when he was 14. And he's like, Mom, I'm too young to get a job. I said, no, you're not. I said, you can do your own job.
Yeah.
Right? And you can create your own little lawn care business going around. So as that age is like 17, being an entrepreneur, and like I said, look at the internet business these days.
Oh my goodness, yes, yeah.
You know, all these kids being millionaires and they're not even hit 16.
That's right, yeah.
Right? It's crazy.
And that's can you imagine I'm going to say way back when, because I'm almost 60. Can you imagine that kind of stuff? I mean, I think about it. If I was young and they had the internet back when, my goodness, because I come from the same background, similar to what you're saying. My parents, at least my parents did. I started working for myself way before anybody even thought about a kid should be working for himself. Because my father is the same way. He says, you don't have to go get a job. You can go get a job.
Yeah.
But you don't have to go get a job.
I fell into it, right? Because I was hairdressing at college. And we'd have all the ladies coming in on a weekly basis to get the hair done, and they would say to me, "Well, what am I going to do when you're not here?" And I said, "Well, I'll come to your house."
There you go.
And that was how it started. I started my own hairdressing round.
Yeah.
Right, and it wasn't. Yeah. I didn't go out there and push myself, and then it just grew from there. I never advertised. It was never that big thing on marketing and advertising and internet and blah blah blah. It was just like I had a really good round, and I got into a church. Whatever they call them, you know, all the people that go to all same the people, church. You know,
right.
You had
automatic clients.
Yeah, like you get it with a church community, you are set. Let me tell you.
And everything's got to get done before they get to church. So you got clients, you know, you got deadlines that they create for you. You know, they're creating the deadlines. I need this done now. No problem.
All right.
Got another one. Sorry to cut you off with that, but we'll talk some more. From the age of 25. Mm-hmm. To this very moment, what advice would you give your children outside of don't go on Paxton's show? No.
You know what? I've told my kids, so I got into nutrition, and from nutrition I got into, I've always told my kids, you know, my life has been fate. But I actually didn't realize that I directed that fate. And the last few years, I've really got into teaching my brain that what I want in life is easy if I know how to direct it. And so that's what I've been doing, and that's what I've been doing with my kids too. And I continually train them to realize and understand. And I mean, God, I wish I knew this when I was 16 or 15.
Tell me about it.
Wish I knew. Oh, that my thoughts created my future.
Yeah.
And they do. You know, when I came to Canada, my girlfriend said to me, why don't you go and be a nanny in Canada? And I'm like, Canada? Because in England, we never hear about Canada. You hear about the US, you never hear about Canada. I'm like, Canada? Who the hell's in Canada? And the more
your neighbor's going to get you for that one.
Yeah. And the more I thought about it, I thought, you know what? I can do this. Yeah, why not? Like, for a change. And then literally within a week, in my local newspaper, there was an article looking for nannies in Canada.
Look at that.
Of course, they got one of the families and they brought me over to Canada, and I've been here ever since.
Wow.
My goodness. What you think about, and this is really important for everybody, what you think about, your thoughts create your future. It's so important. One of my daughters got her car that she built, that she literally thought about. And I said, it doesn't matter how you get it. Just dream it, believe it, see yourself driving it. She's like, Mom, I'm doing that every night. And yes, that's exactly what she got. She got the exact car that she wanted. My other daughter, she's working where she wants to work. She went to, when she went to school and she had to do a placement, she went to the school, and I said, well, just, you've been there, you know the people, so go and ask. And I said, do you see how your thoughts create what you do? So you and so I keep having to reiterate, and I'm trying to do that with my son because he's a little bit more lazy than the girls. So I keep having to say to him, what do you want? Where's your house? How many cars do you want? Do you see them? How many do you have? And so I'm kind of trying to open the doors for them to understand that where your thoughts go, that's where your future's going to go.
If I had to end the show anyway other than this, it would not work. You ended the show in such a beautiful way. You are a beautiful person. You're an amazing personality. I wanted you on simply because of that, because I wanted to be able to showcase that you are a highly intelligent woman, a very beautiful personality, and you have a way of getting your man to buy you the flooring and anything else that you want by using the H word.
He's watching too.
But using the H word, he has been well trained and no doubt well rewarded for doing his job. All right. Beautiful family, beautiful house, beautiful things you have. And you're still sticking it out with this silly COVID stuff. And you ended the show in such a beautiful way. So until I see you again, and I will, I'm looking forward to having you on, talk more about nutrition. Very, very much so. I have a whole set of stuff about nutrition to go on. I just knew I couldn't do it all in 1 hour. So thank you very much. I appreciate it, Jill.
Thank you for having me.
You're fantastic. We'll see you soon. Take care. Yeah. Okay. Thank you, everybody that came on. We'll see everybody later. We'll talk to you soon. Bye-bye.
Bye.